This will be lesson 2.3, and I want to talk about different kinds of definitions in this lesson. But before we get into the specifics, I want to say a little something about what this has to do with arguments. When we're trying to understand arguments, and when we're trying to evaluate arguments, an issue that comes up is the language that's used in arguments. Now, there are lots of ways in which language can be unclear. Let me bring up a couple of pre-concrete examples, and I want to talk about ambiguity and vagueness. You may hear these terms used interchangeably sometimes, but in the logic classroom, ambiguity and vagueness refer to two different phenomena. Ambiguity is when a word or phrase has more than one distinct meaning. So, for example, the word bank can mean a financial institution. On the other hand, it can also mean the side of a river. When the various meanings of a word are completely different, as we have with the two meanings of bank, that's not so likely to cause difficulty. On the other hand, if we have a word or phrase with several distinct meanings, but they're similar meanings, then this can cause confusion. There's a famous example of this involving the President of the United States. Back in the 90s, when Bill Clinton was president, he was accused of having a sexual relationship with his intern, Monica Lewinsky. He came on TV and said, "I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky." So now the phrase sexual relations was interpreted by most people to mean any kind of a sexual relationship. So he said he didn't have a sexual relationship. Then later, it turns out there was a sexual relationship. And when he's accused of lying, he says, "Oh, no, no, see, I didn't lie. Down in Arkansas, where I come from, sexual relations, that means one specific act, which is intercourse, right? And there was no sexual relations," if you understand what I mean by sexual relations, right? So an ambiguity in the phrase sexual relations caused some confusion there, the meanings being similar, but not quite the same. Now, vagueness is a different sort of an animal. Vagueness is where you have a word or phrase that, even within one kind of meaning, doesn't have precise conditions of application. That is, we know how to use the word as it's intended, but it's not intended to have exact conditions where you apply it. So, for example, the word tall. We know how to use the word tall. We know there are examples of people who clearly are tall. Shaquille O'Neal, clearly tall. People who clearly are not tall, such as Vern Troyer, the mini-me guy. But exactly how tall someone has to be in order to be considered tall, there isn't like a certain cutoff height, a certain number. And you can't just say like it's the average. That's, you know, somebody who's taller than average is tall, like taller than 5'11", I guess, maybe for a man. So if somebody's 5'11" and 1/8", they're tall. But somebody else who's 5'10" and 7/8" is not tall. You put them next to each other, you can't really tell which one's the tall one, which one's not. That doesn't seem to be how the word tall is supposed to be used. So instead, it's a vague term. But when this is involved in an argument, this can cause difficulty in deciding whether it's a good argument or not, because right, there's, if the argument's conclusion involves a precise conclusion, right, but the premise is something that's vague, then you got a problem, right? And by the way, a word can be both vague and ambiguous. So for example, the word rich can mean more than one thing. It can mean food that's very sweet, or it can also mean a person has a lot of money. And both of those meanings is also vague, right? Exactly how much money or exactly how sweet is not it's not something that's precisely defined. So those are some issues that arise. Now, there's various ways we can try to sort of resolve these issues of unclarity. And one of the main ways, or maybe just the most concrete way, would be by giving definitions. It's important to understand if you're giving definitions, or someone's giving definitions, there's different kinds of definitions. So the type of definition being given might be different. There's a couple of distinctions made in the book about definitions that describe versus definitions that sort of use an example. And it's not always better to have the definitions that describe. So for example, if somebody says, if somebody doesn't know what a cockatiel is, right? And they ask you what a cockatiel is. You say, look it up in the dictionary, and you find something like, a cockatiel is a member of the species Nymphicus hollandicus. All right, there you go. Now you know what it is, right? On the other hand, someone could say, what's a cockatiel? And you show them some cockatiels or picture some cockatiels and say, well, a cockatiel is a bird like this or other similar related birds. So now, which of those two people is going to have a better understanding of what a cockatiel is? I don't think it's going to be the one who looked up that dictionary definition. So sometimes a description like that's not the best, but nevertheless, it's sort of something we could say, I think, maybe more about. So I want to focus on giving definitions in terms of words, in terms of describing the thing. And we can make some distinctions when it comes to this kind of definition, some subtypes. The two main kinds of definitions of this type are a stipulative definition and a lexical definition. And I think of these two as kind of extremes on a spectrum, where stipulative is a kind of one extreme and then lexical is the other. So let's start with the stipulative definition. A lot of times I think people think of stipulation when you think of a definition. It declares a meaning. So it declares what a word or phrase means. A lot of times it's going to be the first time the word or phrase appears. And the person just, you know, is making it up. And they just decide, this is how I'm going to use this word. So it can't be wrong. I can use the word however I want. So for example, let's say I come up with a new product. I come up with a shoe that has a little clock in the toe of the shoe, right? And I think this would be great. It'd look cool, have a little clock in there. And also you could look at if you're holding things in your hands, you can't take out your phone and see what time it is. You can just kind of hold up your foot and look down at it and say, oh, it's afternoon, I gotta go. So I come up with this thing. I design this shoe clock, this shoe with the clock in it, and I have to come up with a name for it. So I say it's going to be called Ora Scarpa. So Ora Scarpa is a shoe with the clock in it. Now, it can't be wrong. Nobody can tell me that's not what Ora Scarpa really means. It means this other thing. That's ridiculous. I just decided that that's what it means. On the other hand, it could be misleading, especially if somebody declares a new meaning for a word that already means something else, right? Which is kind of a strange thing to do, but I guess, you know, people could do it. If I say, I want you to come over to my house and I'm going to make some chicken, and then you come over and you're eating this stuff and you say, well, this, you know, is the strangest chicken that I've ever had. And I say, oh, I forgot to tell you. Right. I use the word chicken, see, in a different way. When I say chicken, I always mean human flesh. And that's just how I use the word.
Right.
Technically, is that an incorrect use of the word? Well, I mean, I can stipulate that I use this word in a different way. It's kind of strange because it seems to be defeating the point of language. So it's kind of a strange thing to do. But I guess technically it's not incorrect. It's misleading, though. And then the other extreme is a lexical example or a lexical definition. And a lexical definition, instead of declaring a meaning, it's trying to describe an existing meaning. So we have a word or phrase, it already means something, and normally we're going to be talking about a word or phrase with origins in ordinary language. So when words arise in ordinary language, how that process works, you might think, well, probably starts as a stipulative definition, right? And then somehow it becomes standard usage. But it may be more murky than that, because when you look at recent arrivals in terms of words, look at the word selfie, right? Recently, the Oxford English Dictionary, the Webster's Dictionary, all the main dictionaries, they include the word selfie now. How did that become a word, selfie? Where did it come from? Was there like a stipulation? Was there a moment when someone, you know, put a maybe a video out there on the internet or a page, a web page, and they declared, I'm having been in a word, selfie, and here's what it means exactly. Exactly, and they stipulated that. I don't think that's quite how that happens. No, there's this kind of murky process where somehow or another somebody starts using the word, and then somebody else picks up on that. They never really officially declare maybe what it means, so they have this murky origin. And these types of words typically are the kind of words that we see lexical definitions for. And if you look up words in the dictionary definitions are almost all lexical. They're never stipulative. There's some other types that we'll talk about, but they're mostly lexical definitions. Dictionary writers try to figure out how ordinary people are using words, or if they're specialists in some cases, you know, they may try to figure out how specialized communities are using words, and then they try to describe that. Here's a little bit of a tangent, but I think it's significant to understanding a lexical definition. The dictionary is not there to clear up imprecision in word use that hasn't been cleared up by the linguistic community already. So they can only describe. They're not like, the dictionary writers are not like lords of language. They're not there to declare, here's how you must use this word. So for example, if we have a word, like in another philosophy class, we might talk about something like knowledge and say, exactly what is knowledge? And start thinking about cases where, you know, you might question whether something counts as knowledge or not. And sometimes students will sort of out of frustration to say, I'm just going to look it up in the dictionary. Here, look it up in the dictionary is what it says in the dictionary. And if you understand this about dictionary definitions, then you see that that's not going to help, right? Because if there's something that the linguistic community hasn't cleared up about exactly what knowledge is, the dictionary writers don't sit down and say, well, we're gonna fix that. We're going to tell everybody how to use it. They can only describe up to what the linguistic community has already sort of resolved. So that's not what those definitions are for. That's not what dictionary definitions are for. And dictionary definitions can be wrong. Lexical definitions can be wrong. In fact, we're going to get into problems with lexical definitions next, and you'll see that it's quite difficult to come up with a perfect lexical definition. Maybe most of the definitions in the dictionary might not be perfect. In any case, that's the essence of a lexical definition. Now, there are a couple of other types of definitions that I would say fall somewhere between stipulative and lexical on this sort of scale that I'm describing. And one is a precising definition. A precising definition involves a certain amount of stipulation, but it also involves the ordinary meaning of a word. Because a precising definition sort of starts with the existing meaning and then modifies it. And it modifies it just by declaring precise boundaries so that it becomes precise. So for example, a word that is vague, we talked about the word rich being vague, but suppose you needed it to be precise because you wanted to use it like, say, in a legal context or something, right? A tax form or something. I mean, not that they do, but suppose you did. So you want to say exactly what it means. You know, you want rich people to file this tax form, and then you know, other people file a different tax form, let's say. So you make a you partially stipulate a meaning of rich. So you say rich for our purposes in this form or whatever means that you earn more than $300,000 a year. And there's a phrase like for our purposes or for purposes of or something like that is a lot of times accompanies a precising definition because it sort of indicates that you're aware there's this ordinary definition and then you're slightly modifying or slightly changing that. So that's a precising definition. Now, even more toward the stipulative side of things than a precising definition is what we call a theoretical definition. And what I mean by theoretical here is that it declares the meaning of a word or phrase within the context of a theory. So there's some kind of background theory involved, understanding of which may even be necessary for understanding the definition itself, and it may involve other terms from that are involved in this theory that are defined in other ways. A lot of times a theoretical definition would be the kind of definition that a specialist or a technical definition that a specialist sits down and comes up with. Defines a term in a certain way to make a theory work. And a lot of times a theoretical definition is going to specify a way to measure this whatever's being defined. One thing I should make clear about this, and I make this point about it being a specialist definition, that's one way of distinguishing theoretical from lexical definitions. Normally, a lexical definition is not like the kind of definition that a specialist, say, in some science, biology or physics or something, sits down and comes up with this definition. It's, like I said, it's a word that just appears on the scene in whatever weird way ordinary language makes words appear on the scene. And then a theoretical definition is something that someone, you know, sits down, a specialist sits down and comes up with this definition. One thing I don't mean by theoretical definition, and it's important to get this, is like theoretical in the sense that something might be wrong, like it might be incorrect, like theoretically he should be there but he might not be there. That's not what I mean by theoretically here. Theoretical here means that it's involved in a theory. Doesn't mean that the theory is something we're not sure about. An example of a theoretical definition would be the definition of force in Newtonian physics, which is mass times acceleration. I think that's the defining equation. There are a couple other equations, but I think that's the defining one. And I think you have the definition of acceleration, like in terms of mathematics, and then the definition of mass in terms of, you know, amount of matter, and then matter is sort of a basic concept. You can tell that this is a theoretical definition as opposed to a lexical definition. The word force had some kind of meaning in ordinary language before modern physics came on the scene, but that meaning was something you could probably only describe in kind of a almost circular way, or just give synonyms for. You'd have to say force is like a pushing or making something happen or something like that. It wouldn't be this, you know, ordinary people wouldn't have come up with this mass times acceleration definition, right? So that's one way of distinguishing, or most of the time being able to tell the difference between theoretical and lexical definitions. Now there's one more type of definition that is separate from this whole scale between the stipulative and lexical thing, and that is what we call a persuasive definition. It doesn't have anything to do with stipulating or not. When someone gives a persuasive definition, it's a bad thing. It's a kind of definition that you shouldn't be giving, or someone shouldn't be giving you, because it's a definition that's more concerned with making the thing sound good or bad than actually describing what it is. So, for example, say somebody wants a definition of matrimony. Say a little kid is at school. He hears the word matrimony. So he comes home and asks his dad, "Dad, they said they were using the word matrimony at school, and I don't know what that means. What's matrimony?" So his dad tells him, "Son, matrimony is the point in a man's life at which it becomes futile for him to go on any longer. He becomes enslaved to this other person who he tells him what to do, and he can't go out with his friends anymore, and it sucks." And so, you know, kid's gonna say, "Oh, that sounds terrible. I still have no idea what it is," right? Or imagine he goes to somebody, you know, somebody makes it sound good. He goes to his priest or something, you know, and says, "Father McGillicuddy, I heard the word matrimony being used. What does that mean?" And, you know, Father McGillicuddy's gonna say, "Oh, my son, matrimony is the holiest of sacraments and the blessed way in which God intended human beings to go about this earth two by two." And, you know, this kid's gonna say, "Oh, that sounds fantastic," right? "I still don't have no idea what it is," right? So that's a persuasive definition. Of course, it's only a persuasive definition if it makes the term sound good or bad unnecessarily. So, for example, if the word just means something is bad, then it's not persuasive to say that. Of course, it's not persuasive. Like, if I'm defining evil and I say that, you know, evil is maleficence or causing harm or cruelty, especially a supernatural force that's malevolent, you shouldn't say, "Well, that's just a persuasive definition. You're trying to make evil sound like something bad." Well, I'm not trying to make it sound like something bad. Like, that's what the word means. So that's not a persuasive definition in that case. So let's just focus on the five types of definitions that are described in section 2.3, and you should be able to identify what kind of definition you're being given based on what we said here.